The views expressed in the following program are those of the participants and do not necessarily reflect the views of Saga 960 AM or its management.
Welcome to nFocus. I'm your host, Annie Koshy, on In Focus with Annie J. Koshy. Now, my show is all about spotlighting remarkable individuals and their stories. Each week, I dive into really engaging conversations with inspiring guests from diverse backgrounds who've made a significant impact on their communities and beyond. Today, I'm thrilled to have Rosa Cao Liu, who is my guest for today's show. Rosa's journey as an Asian and Latin American immigrant from Venezuela to Canada is nothing short of remarkable. She's accomplished so much, including earning her Bachelor of Business Administration with numerous accolades. I'm excited to welcome her to the show and to hear her incredible story. Rosa, it's fantastic to have you here.
Thank you so much, Annie. I am so thrilled to be here and excited to share my experiences with the audience.
Well, Rosa, your journey from Venezuela to Canada is incredibly inspiring. Can you share more about your experiences growing up in Venezuela as an Asian Latin American immigrant and how it shaped your perspective and values?
Absolutely. I think like one of the most significant things of being an immigrant or being born in a different country is that you learn their culture and their language as you grow up. And for me, well, I'm very grateful to have been born in Venezuela. It has been one of the most life-changing and life-shaping experiences because it was really interesting that at home, my parents would speak Cantonese to me, but then when I would go out, we would speak in Spanish to my friends and my teachers. So there were some times that I would mix Spanish and Chinese together, but most of it was a really rewarding experience. Venezuelans are really nice.
Now, for my listeners, Rosa was born to Chinese parents. Her cultural background was deeply rooted in China, yet she lived in a Latin American country. And that contrast or duality in her identity caused her to, like many of us who have, a different heritage, caused a bit of confusion for her. In school, how did you feel?
I always felt like I did not fit in, to be quite honest. It was like, I am Chinese, but I'm not fully Chinese because I don't have the full culture and the like full language. And when I'm at school, it's like, oh, I'm not fully Venezuelan. So I always felt like I did not fit in. And I always prefer is the place where I belong to. And it was only after, as I got older, in my teenage years, that I became a little bit more aware of like who I should be and who I am.
Right. Now, in high school, you even had to go through military education, which is something that's mandatory in the last 2 years. What was that like?
Yes, during the last 2 years, as you mentioned, you have to take military education, and it was really challenging. I would say, even though it was really challenging, it was the experience that really shaped who I am today, because during the military experience, you have to learn how to march, how to lead with others, and how to get along well with your fellow cadets. And there's also like workshops and even going through the barrel drill together in groups. And and I recall this very vividly, and even to today, during one of the barrel drills, we had to work as a team and go through the obstacles together, go through the mud together. And that's what I truly learned what it means to have self-discipline, camaraderie, and even leadership skills. I also am thankful for my military instructor because even though he was extremely strict with everything I did,
right,
the main lesson that he taught us was stayed with me until this day. And it was the value of doing things right the first time.
Right.
If you're going to do something, you might as well do it well. Otherwise, don't even bother doing it. And that has stayed with me ever since then.
It's very true. It's incredible how those early experiences somehow shape your work ethic and your attitude. Can you tell us about your decision to come to Canada after high school and the challenges, you know, that you sort of started facing as an immigrant?
Absolutely. At the final year of high school, my parents decided to send me to Canada just to learn English. And that's when I was very excited, very nervous, because I had never traveled before and I barely knew how to speak English. And on top of that, I had to go to Canada on my own. And it was really nerve-wracking because I was only 17 at the time.
Wow, that takes a lot of courage. So you really had to adapt to a new culture, a new education system, as well as life far away from your family and your home. What was attending grade 12 in? Did you choose Ontario right away?
Yes, I chose Ontario right away, specifically Toronto, and because in my first year in Canada, I really enjoyed Toronto. I decided to stay here, and that's when I decided to do grade 12 and then university here.
Did you at any time feel out of place?
Absolutely, especially because when you are a teenager, what's more important for you at that time is to make friends. And at the time, my English skills were not good, and doing grade 12 in Canada was really challenging, not just because of the academic difference in how the teachers teach the academic background and everything. It was mostly about also trying to make friends, also trying to keep up with the classes, and also translating in my head Spanish into English and all these classes. It was really, really frustrating at times, and it was honestly really hard.
You know, your journey is really a testament to your strength and perseverance. And I'm really interested. I'm listening. And along with all of my listeners, you have an incredible story of resilience, of determination, and personal growth. And for those of you who are just tuning in, my guest is Rosa Cao Liu. And before I head into a short break, I want to remind you all that nFocus is about highlighting extraordinary individuals and their journeys. If you have a story to share, whether you're an entrepreneur, an artist, or someone with a unique perspective, do reach out to me at info@saga960am.ca. Attention, Annie or the Ninja. And, you know, I will continue to spotlight incredible individuals and ideas that make our world a better place. Now, stay tuned. I'm going to be back right after this message, and we're going to listen to more of Rosa and her journey and the valuable lessons that she's learned along the way. Remember, if you're listening to In Focus with Annie J. Koshy on Saga 960 AM, stay tuned, stay curious, stay compassionate. I'll be back right after this message.
Stream us live at saga960am.ca.
Welcome back, everyone, to part two of In Focus with Annie J. Koshy. I'm your host, Annie, and I have the privilege of continuing my conversation with the amazing Rosa Cao Liu. Now, for those of you who are just tuning in, Rosa is an Asian American immigrant who has immigrated from, sorry, Asian Latin American immigrant from Venezuela. I almost got the country wrong. And she's not only overcome numerous challenges, but is also on a mission to empower young professionals and students to embrace a growth mindset. Her journey is a true testament to resilience and determination. Rosa, thank you for being with me today. And in the first part, you shared your early life and experiences, the challenges that you faced when you moved to Canada. And it's truly inspiring to hear how you've navigated through these obstacles and really turned them into opportunities for growth. We're going to start talking about some of the challenges that you faced specifically with immigration and the challenges of immigrating to a new country. As an Asian Latin American immigrant from Venezuela, moving to a new country has significant life changes, and you face so many of these along the way. So I want to dive into some of that and some of the realities that immigrants often encounter when starting a new life in Canada. Let's begin with the language barrier. Rosa?
Totally.
Yeah, let's talk about that. That was a big one for you.
Yes, I'd say it was the most challenging one because there we don't really understand or realize how much we want to share and communicate and how impactful it is to be able to communicate with others and so that others can understand us. So to me, the biggest language barrier was that, like, going to the store and wanting to buy something and not being able to ask, how much does this cost? Like, do I have enough money for this? Can I have my money back, or can I have a refund? Like, just asking those simple questions was even, in my head, it felt like a nightmare. And it felt really frustrating at the time that I could not share what I wanted to share with other people. And even if I try, people would not understand me. So it was like this constant fear of, like, am I going to be able to speak? Or should I stay in my comfort zone and not speak, and so that people would never understand me?
Right. So you started reading books and listening to podcasts in English. Now, hats off to you, Rosa, because I can't imagine going to Venezuela and trying to learn Spanish. You did the opposite. You came here with a base of Spanish and Cantonese and had to learn English. How did you work on your speaking and pronunciation? Did you have coaches?
I did not have coaches. It was more of a self-discipline and self-learning. What I would do is that because I didn't know much vocabulary and I realized that was my biggest area of improvement, I decided to, you know what, I'm just going to choose 3 words every week and I'm going to make sentences with that. And I kept doing that every week, three words a week until my day sentences, and I apply them into my everyday speech. But I'd say the biggest advice I can share with everyone who's a new immigrant and also learning the language is to open up a book, open up the newspapers, and just read a paragraph out loud, and then record yourself so you can hear how you're pronouncing it. This is like kind of like an advice for everyone. If you're struggling with English or learning any new language, the great advantage of doing this is such that when you record yourself, you're able to identify and see the gaps between how it's supposed to sound and how you're sounding, and make that difference and keep replying and making changes until you get it right. And it's something that you can do at any point in time, and you can do it on your own.
Wow, that's like a great advice. And that's an incredible level of dedication, Rosa. It's a testament to your determination to adapt and succeed really in a new environment. Now, another significant challenge that you've touched upon is culture shock. Adapting to a new culture, the customs and traditions, they can be very overwhelming. How did you manage to embrace this cultural transition while holding on to your own identity?
Yeah, and that's a great question. I'd say the first thing for me was to really understand why these customs were the way they were, and understand why my customs were like that, and understand having that basis of understanding would allow me to have more respect for my culture and the other culture. So one of the biggest cultural shocks to me was that in Venezuela, we usually have dinner at 8 or 9 p.m., whereas here you have it a lot earlier, at 6 or even 5 p.m. To me, it was a big culture shock. And
you're right. Even the Indian, you know, I'm South Asian, and in the South Asian culture, dinner is served at 8 or 9. But I grew up here and we had dinner as soon as like 6 or 6:30 was when our dinner was, because everyone was hungry after work. And so it was very different when I was living in India and dinner was 9 and everyone went to sleep at 10. I felt like dinner hadn't even gone past my neck, right? It was still stuck there.
Exactly. And for me, that was like, okay, now I need to adjust to the food. And also, like, about the school, even the start time, we start school at 7 a.m. and then we leave around 1 or 2 p.m. depending on high school or primary school. Whereas here you start at 9, and to me that was like one of the biggest culture shocks. I was like, wow, yes, I start later, but then I finish later. So
Right.
it was one of the things of like, okay, I just gotta be flexible and adapt to the environment and just go with the flow.
Now, a term that you use that you embraced was something called cultural humility. Can you explain what that term means to you?
To me, it means that despite having your own differences and your own customs and traditions, is understanding that there's other people with their own customs and traditions. And when it comes to being a different country, you just gotta respect each other. And one way of respecting each other is by understanding their differences and applying. So because I'm already here, then I will apply the challenges, and I will not be disrespectful if I'm like talking to someone. I will not do something else that will be perceived as disrespectful. So it's just about understanding what respect the country and doing the things for them so that you are in a on the same page, if that makes sense.
Beautiful. Now, building meaningful relationships in a new country can be daunting. It can be challenging to make new friends and find like-minded individuals when you're in an unfamiliar place. Can you share some of the insights into how you went about creating and sustaining meaningful relationships in Canada?
So that's a great question. And then I think that's the, one of the biggest things that we face as immigrants. When we go to a new place and you're on your own and with no one around you, you have to put yourself out there to make new friends. So for me, I happened to be in school, so I tried making friends. Even though I had very little communication skills, I would try to speak a little bit, try to say, oh, you like Justin Bieber? Cool, me too. And little things like that to create those meaningful relationships. Because had I not had that resilience and courage to speak up, I would feel like I wouldn't be the person that I am now, and grateful for the opportunities that I had. Because whenever you talk to someone, there's a story behind that, and it's a great that you can always learn something from someone, regardless of their age, regardless of their race, and regardless of what they've been.
And that's a perfect segue into my next question, which is all about networking. Networking is often crucial in one's professional journey, and immigrants often face specific challenges in this regard. How did you navigate networking in a new country, and what advice would you give to others who are trying to meet the right connections in Canada?
A great question, and I'll be quite frank, I did not know anything about networking until I started university. And for me, it was really nerve-wracking because, as I mentioned, my English wasn't great at the time. In my head, I was thinking, how on earth am I going to make connections in a professional manner when I can't even speak the language properly? But it was exactly that. It's having the courage to put yourself out there, say the things that you have to say, and try to be vulnerable in however ways you can be. I think the best thing that you can do when it comes to networking is being your authentic self. Because I feel like everybody can tell when you're trying to get something out of them versus when you're being at your very authentic and very genuine about who you are. You will be more likely to create and sustain those connections, and it will be something that you can do going forward.
Brilliant advice. Now, finding a job is another significant challenge for immigrants. The job search process, unfamiliar professional settings, and the unwritten rules can really be confusing and challenging. How did you navigate this challenge, and what tips would you give to newcomers seeking employment in Canada?
That's a fantastic question. Finding a job is one of the most challenging things that any immigrant can face. But my biggest advice is if you want to have a fulfilling job, is to write down the things that you're naturally good at and passionate about, and then do like a kind of like a quadrant, like naturally good at, not good at, passionate about, and not passionate about. And the quadrant that you want to be at is the intersection between what you're naturally good at and passionate about. And once you know that, and you can put all your effort into allocating and searching for opportunities that align with those things that you're naturally good at and passionate about. And the main reason why I say this is because sometimes we're so focused on the money that we forget that there should be joy in what you do. Because if you don't find joy in that, you'll feel so stressed that you'll eventually be depressed in that job, and you're not gonna be the person that you truly are. So my biggest advice in finding a job is having that connection into what you're naturally good at and passionate about. And when applying for jobs, make sure you target your full self, your true authentic self, into helping the organization with your skills. So my first step is be aware of who you are and then target your skills towards the organizational goals.
Now, living on your own and being independent early in life can be a significant adjustment for immigrants. How did you adapt to this newfound independence? For you, it began at 17. And what lessons did you learn about being resourceful and self-reliant?
The biggest lesson is sometimes your family and your friends will not always be there for you, and you have to find your way out on your own. So the biggest thing is, number one, learn how to cook. If you
Learning
want to
how
put
to,
the be and
yes.
be best version of yourself,
Learning how to
you have to learn how to cook.
cook. Number one thing is learn how to cook. All of you listening in, I think also having an amazing system, support system of friends and mentors, being able to budget for yourself and manage your everyday task. Your journey, Rosa, is a testament to your strength and determination. You've not only navigated all of these challenges, but you've also dedicated yourself to helping others in their path to success. And I believe that your story is incredibly inspiring. I want all of you to understand that Rosa has not been here for an extraordinary amount of time. Her life here in Canada has been relatively new. Her journey as an immigrant to Canada is a powerful testament to resilience and the pursuit of personal and professional growth. Now, I'm going to head into a very brief commercial break, and I want to remind all of you that InFocus is about spotlighting incredible individuals and their inspiring stories. Now, whether you're an entrepreneur, an artist, or someone with a unique perspective, I'm here to amplify your voice. So, if you've missed any part of today's show so far, or you want to catch up on any previous episodes, feel free to visit our website at www.saga960am.ca. Stay with me. I'm going to return. I'll be back right after and continue my conversation with Rosa and explore more about her remarkable journey and her mission to empower others. Stay tuned.
No radio? No problem. Stream us live on saga960am.ca.
Welcome back to In Focus with Annie J. Koshy here on Saga 960. And I'm continuing my conversation with Rosa Cao Liu. She's an incredible individual whose journey as an Asian Latin American immigrant from Venezuela is both inspiring and transformative. She's not just a career advisor and mentor, but a true advocate for personal and professional growth. Now, as I dive deeper into my discussion, you're going to learn how Rosa's resilience and determination have shaped her mission to empower young professionals and university students to embrace a growth mindset, and that ultimately leads to more fulfilling lives. With almost a decade of experience as a career advisor and coach, Rosa's insights are invaluable. Her journey includes obtaining a Bachelor of Business Administration in Management and Human Resources from the esteemed University of Toronto's Scarborough campus in 2017. But Rosa's impact goes beyond her career achievements. She's often described as patient, loving, caring, and kind. She embodies the qualities that inspire and enable those around her. Welcome, Rosa, and thank you for sharing your incredible story with our audience.
Thank you so much for having me here.
Rosa, your journey as an immigrant to Canada is nothing short of remarkable, and you've channeled your experiences into empowering others to embrace a growth mindset and really find fulfillment in their lives. Can you tell us more about the challenges that you faced and how you really overcame them?
The challenges as an immigrant, the way I overcame them, it was one step at a time, because I had this motivation as to why I want to improve and I want to go do it. It doesn't matter what it needs to be done. I want to go and improve and be a better version of myself. So the first thing I did as an immigrant was to focus on the language barrier and looking for ways in which I can improve and adapt to the new culture. And not just that, is being resourceful around university and like meeting my university professors and everything else.
Now, I know that you didn't understand the process for applying for jobs in Canada. You know, there are certain unwritten rules of professional conduct. How did you find those things out? Was it just playing Russian roulette, you know, not knowing and failing and then coming back and learning from that?
Great question. I'd say it was a combination of both, like learning and failing, and also learning from my mentors and people that I had networked with. I was very thankful that in university, they taught us like some of the unwritten rules that we go through corporate life that we have to learn, and some things that I had to learn on the job, because there's some unwritten rules in organizations that are not posted anywhere, and you just have to find out on the day of. So as an immigrant, you have to be mindful of both the experience of others and also the experience on the job, and combining that and trying to understand what is the best that I can do given the circumstances and my skills, and have a professional and happy life.
Now, those are certainly significant challenges, Rosa, and it's remarkable how you not only overcame them, but also used your experience to help others. Can you tell me a little bit more about your work as a growth mentor and career advisor, and how you've translated your own journey into empowering young professionals and students?
Absolutely. One of the things that I truly enjoy, and this was because of university, I had the opportunity to mentor multiple students and help them with the resumes, cover letters, and be that person that I wanted to have at the time. And during this process, I tried to talk to the students and understand what is it that they're naturally good at, what is that they're passionate about, and trying to guide them into becoming better versions, and what is it that they can do to get the job that they want, and what are the unwritten rules that they have to know from an HR perspective when going through those positions. So my role as a career mentor is that combination of using my experience, but also my knowledge of human resources to help them find the career that's best for them.
Now, your work is undoubtedly transformative, Rosa, and your empathy and understanding are really what make you an effective mentor. What would you say is the most rewarding aspect of your work as a growth mentor? And can you share any particular success stories that have stood out for you?
Yes, I have so many, but the one particular one that appears to me, and I can remember right now, there was one student who asked me and told me, "Hey, Rosa, I'm actually not sure if I can do this. Do you believe in me?" I'm like, "Absolutely. Everybody has something unique and special to share with the world." And it was fantastic, because like after we had like this few sessions and conversations, "Hey, I need your advice," I would pick up the phone and like, "Hey, no worries. This is what you can do to handle and navigate that situation." And to me, what was most rewarding is exactly that, going from not knowing and being really doubtful about your future to then taking the steps forward and becoming that person that they envisioned in the first time that they talked to me. So to me, the most rewarding part of being a growth and career advisor is seeing their experiences as they grow and become a better version of themselves.
Your insights are invaluable, Rosa. You really took someone who had low self-esteem and confidence issues, and you stood and guided him, gave him the encouragement and guidance and support that he needed, and made a difference in his life that was truly inspiring. So thank you for shedding light on these really important aspects of the job market, as well as HR practices, and for sharing your perspective on the important topics of diversity and inclusion. You know, I think that my listeners will undoubtedly really benefit from your expertise. Now, can you share any specific examples or anecdotes from your own journey or experiences of other newcomers that highlight the challenges they faced in the Canadian job market, particularly in HR practices and recruitment?
Totally. I think like one of the biggest challenge that I have seen as a new immigrant is because you're fairly new and you're very accustomed and you're very well-educated, highly skilled in your own country. But then when you come to Canada, because you don't know the system and how everything works in terms of human resources practices, then that's when they apply to 100 jobs and they're still wondering, why am I not getting any jobs?
Right.
And I think that one of the main things that I can advise to any new immigrant is that when you're seeking for a job in Canada, you have to make sure you target your skills towards the job description, because, and think about, instead of like, oh, this company can do this for me, and switch that mindset into what can I do with my skills to help this organization achieve their goals. I think that, to me, that was a biggest shift in mindset when applying for jobs and when helping students get into their dream jobs. It is that shift in mindset. Instead of like, it's all about me, it's about what can I do to help the organization achieve their goals.
Brilliant, brilliant advice there. Now, how important is cultural competency when it comes to HR practices and really working in diverse teams? Are there any struggles you can recommend for newcomers to develop cultural competency in the Canadian workplace?
My suggestion would be like being informed about the diversity and inclusion. I think like it's so critical for high performing teams to have diverse experiences. I think when it comes to diverse experiences, it means working with different people. Sometimes we're so used to working with similar personalities, similar type of people, but because we're so similar, we don't see new ideas coming in and absorbing and creating new ways of thinking. And
right.
You know, in this day and age, we have to have an agile team dynamic in order to survive the new trends of AI and all the things. We have to be more adaptable and more agile. And that means we need to have new ways of thinking, being very flexible. And that's why diversity and inclusion is one of the things that nowadays in human resources is so critical, even more so because of artificial intelligence coming in and doing things easier for us.
Now, networking is a critical component of the job seeking process. Could you provide some advice for newcomers on how to effectively network and to build their professional relationships and connect with mentors or industry peers in Canada?
Absolutely. I'd say if you are an immigrant and you're studying in a school, I would say join the communities in your school to have these networking opportunities that are organized by the school. There are tremendous ways for immigrants and like really any young professional to go in networking. My biggest thing when you go into these networking sessions and is don't go in ways with intention of wanting something out of someone. Go with intention of meeting people and connections and how you can add value to their lives, and that value will reciprocate forward, kind of thing. So it's that reciprocity, that in order to earn the trust of someone, you have to be the one delivering and those skills or those things. If that makes sense, it's being the lead by example instead of like asking. How about expressing your ways of thinking and adding value when things eventually will turn out.
Brilliant. Now, in your experience, what role does mentorship play in helping newcomers adapt to the Canadian job market? Do you have any suggestions on making or finding suitable mentors and making the most of mentorship programs?
There's some immigration. I remember there's some immigration groups that they have like a specific mentorship programs. I was very grateful that in my previous organization we had this mentorship program within the organization, and I was paired with a fantastic mentor, very diverse. She was very knowledgeable, and to me that changed my career because it helped me find the confidence that I didn't have back then. When it came to professional environment, corporate environment, and all the things. So the biggest role of a mentorship is that duality of that. Yes, you are the mentor of someone, but they are also your men. They are also
Mentee.
your mentee because you share in experiences, and together you collaborate to help each other grow in ways that you wouldn't thought you could do on your own.
Now, you've mentioned the importance of embracing one's unique experiences. Can you elaborate on how newcomers can leverage their diverse backgrounds and perspectives to contribute to innovative problem solving and creativity within their organizations?
Absolutely. I think like immigrants have a different way of thinking. So when they bring that back here and we are trying to problem solve in a different team, you can bring and speak about your ideas and share with the team while being respectful of everybody else's. But it is embracing the essence of who you truly are as a person, as a different race, as a different language, as a different culture, really embracing that and sharing. And having a mindset of like, I'm here to help and I want to see what I can add value to the organization, to the people that I interact with.
Now, these questions can really help delve deeper into the topics of HR practices from diversity and inclusion, and also provide insights on how newcomers can navigate the Canadian job market effectively. So I want to say thank you, Rosa, for a really enlightening conversation right now. And we've really delved into the intricacies of job seeking here in Canada, the value of diverse experiences, and how immigrants can really bring in their unique experiences and expertises to the workplace. Now, I'm going to take a short break right now, and I want to leave you with a glimpse of what's coming up next in my final segment. Rosa is going to share her inspiring future goals. You can imagine she's got quite a number that she's going to let us know, and how she plans to make a positive impact. So stay tuned, and I'm going to be right back after this short message.
Stream us live at saga960am.ca.
Welcome back to the last segment of In Focus with Annie J. Koshy, and I've been very fortunate to have Rosa Cao Liu with me, and she's been sharing her incredible journey and insights into the challenges faced by immigrants here in Canada. Now, as I wrap up this inspiring conversation, I'm really going to delve into Rosa's future goals and how she intends to make a positive impact. So without further ado, let's continue this conversation, Rosa. You've shared your ambitious goals to become a motivational speaker and inspire others with your story. Can you tell me a little bit more about the specific themes or topics that resonate with you, and what are you eager to speak on?
Certainly, one of my favorite things is because I'm a career and growth coach, I want to talk about how people can grow. I feel like right now in today's world, we are so focused on staying where we are. And we're like simply comparing ourselves to others that we really are not realizing our truest potential and our own inner strength. I feel like one of the things that I've seen, not only in Venezuela, but also here in Canada, is that we're constantly comparing ourselves like, oh, this person did great in this exam. I should do even better. Well, this person got a great job. I should get an even better job. And to me, that's amazing. But there's other things that you can do, and realizing who you truly are makes a big difference.
Okay, I would like you to say that little bit for all of my Spanish listeners who are listening right now. So tell me that same answer. What are your thoughts about some specific themes or topics that you would like to speak about as a motivational speaker, and how can you inspire them with their story?
So it will be about growth mindset, and it's because we are constantly comparing ourselves.
You're going to say this in Spanish. So say
Oh, in Spanish. Oh, okay. Perfect. Quisiera hablar de la mentalidad de crecer, de crecimiento, porque estamos constantemente comparándonos con otros, que no nos damos cuenta de quiénes somos y de nuestros talentos únicos que podemos florecer y ser mejores mismos. Creo que es una de las cosas que debemos de aprender, es esa mentalidad de crecimiento y que siempre estás aprendiendo y nunca dejes de crecer.
Wow, now that's a fantastic message. And you spoke specifically about things like resilience, about determination, about having a positive attitude. And I think all of those are really a fantastic message. Rosa, where can people find you on social media? What's the best place that they can get a hold of you?
The best place that you can get a hold of me right now is through LinkedIn. So for those of you, www.linkedin.com/in/Rosa Cao Liu, you can reach me there. And I don't have
So,
currently.
for those of you who didn't hear how to spell her name, it's Rosa and Caoliu. That's Rosa Caoliu. And you can find Rosa on LinkedIn. Now, in terms of reaching a broader audience, what are your plans or dreams for sharing your story with more?
Totally. So my biggest thing in terms of like future goals is to be able to write a book and share my story to as how many people as I possibly can. It has been one of the things that I always wanted to do and becoming a life coach. But my main goal and my intention is to be able to inspire others with my story and to help them become better versions of themselves.
So ultimately, I guess you would like to participate in conferences and workshops. I see you actually on many stages, being able to share your story, but also ultimately motivating a lot of people who come with great dreams in their eyes and face a lot of discouragement and disappointment in the initial years. I think that the impact that you can have, first off, of sharing your story, but also helping them navigate some of the pitfalls in the initial years of being a new immigrant is brilliant. Do you have a roadmap in terms of the content that you're considering for your book?
I have a roadmap. Not yet, but what I really want to share is no matter who you are and no matter where you're from and the circumstances that you've been through, you are constantly growing by your willpower. Just circumstantial, and you can always get out of any situation as long as you keep going and having a growth mindset.
Finally, Rosa, for my listeners who are aspiring to achieve their personal and professional goals, much like you have, what advice would you offer them to help them on their journey?
My biggest advice would be to really tune in into who they are. I'm not sure if many people believe in this, what's called intuition, but intuition is our gut feeling that something is right for me. If you can do this exercise with any decision that you're making, and this is an exercise that you can do anywhere, anytime, but especially if like this is a quiet place, close your eyes and then put like instrumental music or music that helps you relax. And take a few deep breaths and then ask yourself, how would I feel if I were to do X? And then just tuning into your body and listening to what your body says. And then ask the same question again. How would my body feel? How would I feel if I were to choose why. And if you've noticed that your body's starting to get really tensed or really relaxed, then the one option that makes you really tense is the one that is not for you. And the one that makes you feel really relaxed is the option that your own intuition is telling you this is for you.
Thank you for those inspiring words, Rosa. Your journey and your aspirations were truly motivational. And we look forward to seeing you and your continued success in the future. Now, it's evident that your work has a profound impact on those you mentor. As we wrap up my conversation with you, could you share a piece of advice or a mantra that has personally guided you, and what would you like to pass on to my listeners today?
A great question, and I think it would be just be yourself. Don't compare yourself to others and just be your true authentic self. Let no one like you, and that's your true superpower.
And to my listeners, thank you for joining me on In Focus with Annie J. Koshy. Remember that you can reach out to me if you have a story to share, or whether you're an entrepreneur, an artist, or someone with a unique perspective. Just email me at info@saga960am.ca, attention Annie or the Ninja. Let's keep spotlighting the incredible individuals and ideas that make our world a better place. If you've missed any part of today's show or want to catch up on previous episodes, please visit our website at www.saga960am.ca, where there will be a podcast of this and other engaging conversations. Stay curious, stay compassionate, and stay tuned for In Focus on Saga 960 AM. Until next time, have a fantastic day and continue to be your beautiful self.
No radio? No problem. Stream us live on saga960am.ca.